know that Jason received Jesus as Lord and Savior. I don't know if you understand the gravity of this particular baptism, but it was just a few years ago that his mother was led to Christ, and I got to baptize her. And now here, I get to baptize her son. It's the first time I've ever baptized a mother and her son. So it's a pretty big deal. Amen. Baptism is a big deal anyway, right? Praise the Lord for that. As Baptists, you know, we celebrate and acknowledge two ordinances that Jesus left us with. One is the Lord's Supper, right? We have the Lord's Supper, which we will be doing next month. The other is baptism. Hence, we're Baptist, therefore we baptize, okay? And we baptize by full immersion, all right? So, with that said, Jason, what is your profession of faith?
Lord Jesus Christ.
All right. Lord Jesus Christ, he says. I don't know if y'all heard him or not. All right. Let me have you in. I'm a little vertically challenged. All right. Jason, my brother, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and Holy Spirit, buried with him in death, resurrected to live for life.
Good morning. And praise the Lord for that. Thank you all for being here. And my daughter Delaney is here. She's going to be helping us out. And hopefully the kids will cooperate and we'll have a wonderful day. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We ask you to please be in this place, to fill this place and fill us with your Spirit. Guide us today. Help us to learn, to love. And we just thank you, Lord. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Glad I remembered that before. Thank you.
Come.
Excuse me. You want to carry the
Thank you. kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart.
On earth as in heaven.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the blessings that you have given us and that you are working in and through us. And now, pray that you are, Brother James, as you bring this message, pray that you bless each and every one of us, that we will have your heart and your wisdom and your peace. In Christ's name, I pray. Amen.
All right, all right, all right. Good morning, church. How's everybody doing?
Fine. Start up.
That was pretty weak. How's everybody doing?
Good.
Good.
Amen.
You guys are a tough crowd, I can tell you. I want to thank everybody. Obviously, I was not here last week. For whatever reason, I attracted COVID. Angela didn't have it, but because she was around me, she stayed home as well, so we stayed in quarantine. Interestingly enough, though, the sermon that I preached right before that was about how sin is the direct cause, underlying direct cause of all things evil that happen, even sicknesses, but I did say that not all the time is it a direct sin that you have committed that caused you to get sick or to have a difficult problem. I'm just justifying that because one of my brothers called and said, I'm praying that you're not sick because of a sin you've committed. And so I'm just clarifying, no, it wasn't sick for that. We're going to continue through John's Gospel, John chapter 9. 2 weeks ago, we looked at the verses 1 through 12. Today, we're going to pick up in verse 13. We're going to carry all the way through verse 23. So with that said, and without further delay, I'm going to go ahead and ask that you stand in honor of God's Word. John, the Gospel writer, has for us, out of the English Standard Version, John 9, verse 13. They brought to the Pharisees a man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. So the Pharisees again asked how he had received his sight. And he said to them, he put mud in my eyes and I washed and I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? And there was a division among them, so they said again to the blind man, what do you say about him since he opened your eyes? He said, he is a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who received his sight and asked them, is this your son whom you say was born blind? How then now does he see? His parents answered, we know that this is our son, that he was born blind, but how he now sees, we do not know. Nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age, he will speak for himself. His parents said these things because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone should confess Jesus to be the Christ, he was to be put out of the synagogue, and therefore his parents said, he is of age, ask him. Our Heavenly Father God, we submit and surrender everything at this church and within us to you, Father. We pray in the name of Jesus that your Holy Spirit heavily invades each and every one of us, Father, that we would depart here not the same as we enter. Lord God, I ask that you stand me behind the cross, that your will may be done. And I ask all these things by the in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I figured at least I'd get one amen out of you. All right. So 2 weeks ago, when I preached on the first 12 verses, we learned a couple different things about that. One of the things is that Jesus is always the one seeking. We are never the ones seeking after him. And he may be seeking you through his word. He may be seeking you through another individual. However you come to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, make no mistake, it was Jesus that initiated that, because he is the one that's always seeking us. What we also were able to witness out of that is Jesus can take what is the seemingly impossible and make it possible. And that's a big thing for us. And only Jesus can open the eyes of the blind. Only Jesus can do that. As we now pick up in verse 13, I'm going to ask y'all, and I think you know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask you anyway. You know what a partition is? It's a thing that goes in a room, divides a room. In the big industrial buildings nowadays, the only people that have actual offices are the ones that have the perimeter offices. They're generally the ones that are the bosses. Everybody else in the center sits in the cubicles, right? And the cubicles have those little walls that partition one off from the other, so they call them their office. If we were to take some of those partitions and line them up down the center of this room, separating this room so that we had one sanctuary on this side and one sanctuary on this side, we could theoretically simultaneously have two different services at the same time. What I know for sure is those two services would be teaching the truth, right? However, as we're going to see in our text, the Pharisees have, in a sense, erected a partition between the teaching that they're teaching the Jews in Israel and the teaching that Jesus is teaching the Jews in Israel. Your sermon title today is Unprecedented Incident. Unprecedented Incident. Never happened before. Verse 13, as we look at our first point, he must have come from God. Verse 13 says, they brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Already there's some information there that we need to draw into this particular text so that we understand. The Jews, as you remember, and if you weren't here, you can go back and look at the video, but the Jews are the overseers, when you say Jews, it's Pharisees, are overseers of the Word of God in Israel during this time, and actually all over, okay? They are, for lack of better words, the scriptural heroes. They're who people go to learn, right? And so for them to bring this man before the Pharisees, to us may seem a little bit strange, but in reality, in their time, it wasn't strange at all. You see, in their time, what they had got to witness, or what they got to see, was a miraculous work of God had been done, and a man had been taken from blindness and given sight. Kind of like our spiritual state without Jesus. We're blind, running into walls until we receive Jesus, and then we are born again and we're able to see. We're able to be able to read and understand and fellowship with other believers in Christ and prayerfully lost souls as well, so we can lead them to Christ. But I said that to say this. In that text 2 weeks ago, immediately when the man came back seeing, his neighbors and some of the Jews that had seen him before as a blind man were asking some questions. Some of them were saying, is this the same man that used to sit in the front of the temple and beg? And others said, no, it's not him, but it's somebody that looks like him. And so they can't explain or can't wrap their heads around how this man could have gone from being blind his entire life to all of a sudden, instantaneously, being able to see. So when the people bring this man to the Pharisees, They're bringing this man to the Pharisees seeking some sort of understanding of the miraculous work of God that's been done in this man. In verse 14, it goes on to say, now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened the man's eyes. Jesus is radical, isn't he? I mean, he's intentionally stirring the pot. If you think he's not, you read your text a little bit closer. Jesus is intentionally stirring the pot, and he's intentionally stirring that pot because there is a problem, isn't there? There's a problem in Israel because the Pharisees who came about during the intertestamental period, the Pharisees had taken the Old Testament, which they had full knowledge of, and even the Jews, other Jews in Jerusalem had it at the time. They took the Old Testament, applied what fit into their life, so they basically turned it into a buffet, applied what fit into their life, and then created the Talmud and the Mishnah, which was the additional rules and laws and regulations that all of the people of Israel were supposed to abide by. So when Jesus does this on the Sabbath, Jesus is deliberately stirring things up. He's deliberately stirring things up. Not only that, by doing it on the Sabbath, he was, as far as the Pharisees were concerned, he was violating Pharisaical law. He wasn't violating God's law. Let me make that clear to you. He was violating Pharisaical law, the Pharisees' law that was written in the Mishnah. The Mishnah had 39 laws, and in those 39 laws, one of them was that you couldn't do any type of physical work. When Jesus spit on the ground and then bit down and started kneading that mud together to put it on the guy's eyes, as far as they were concerned, Jesus was deliberately violating their Sabbath. And they're mad. They're mad. So mad that some of the Pharisees, then the Pharisees asked the man how he received his sight. He said to them, he put mud on my eyes and washed, and I see. Second time the man has been interrogated. The first time was by his neighbors and people that had seen him in front of the temple area previously. So he was interrogated by them. How did you receive your sight? He said, the man put mud on my eyes. I went and washed, came back seeing. The Pharisees asked, how did you receive your sight? He says, the man put mud on my eyes. I went and washed. I came back seeing. The man is consistent in his testimony. And you know as well as I do, if you're trying to get to the bottom of an issue, and I'm going to take it into your context that you're very familiar with, you're trying to get to the truth of something that one of your kids did. Okay? And so you begin to interrogate them to find out exactly what happened. Now, one of them is going to come up with some kind of off-the-wall, out-of-the-planet answer, right? Yep. The other one, most likely, is either going to agree with that or give you a different answer. And if you continue to press on a little bit further, one of them is giving you the truth and the other one is not. This man unapologetically is saying, the man put mud on my eyes, I went and washed, I came back, and I can see. In other words, listen to the words coming out of my mouth, right? But that upset the Pharisees so bad that some of them said, this man cannot be from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. He does not keep the Sabbath. Do you realize, and if not, let me try to share this with you, and then you can go study it later. In Exodus chapter 20, where the Ten Commandments is given, in there, the commandment to keep the Sabbath and keep it holy is given. God gave us that. But if you go back and look at the context of what God's expectations were for you to keep the Sabbath holy, it meant that you were due to do everything in your power to not do any physical labor, to not do any labor, right? It didn't say if you did labor, you've sinned against me. It doesn't say that in there. It was God's gift, and we miss this all of the time. The Sabbath was God's gift to man. God didn't need to rest. God ain't resting right now. God had never rested all eternity, right? The Sabbath was given to man as a gift. God knew that we would wear out. He knew that we would wear down. That may very well be how I contracted COVID, because I don't know how to stop, right? A little hyperactive, never slow down, always going somewhere. And maybe my immunity system just got a little weak, and that may be how I got COVID. I don't know, but what I do know is this. They are mad, this group of them are mad because Jesus violated their Sabbath. As I just mentioned, he didn't violate what's written in the Old Testament. He violated what's written in the Mishnah. The Mishnah, if you're not familiar with that, is one part of a book that has two parts in it that the Jewish religious leaders wrote early on in this time of history, and that was what they were teaching everybody and holding everybody accountable to. In other words, what they were doing was creating their own Bible, creating their own God, creating their own religion, and trying to hold everybody else accountable to that. Let me give it to you a little clearer. They created a cult. Okay? That's the definition of what a cult is. A cult is somebody that desires to manipulate the Word of God to fit into their particular agenda, and then acquires people to submit to that to submit to that type of teaching, right? And they get wandered off on a wayward path. That's exactly what the Pharisees were doing, and that's why Jesus deliberately did this on the Sabbath. He was trying to teach not only the Pharisees, but all of the other Jews in Israel at this particular time. He was trying to teach them that anything that you have learned up to this point about the Sabbath is wrong. How do we know that? If you remember, earlier back, the Pharisees got so upset with Jesus that they sent some officers out to arrest him. Right? And the officers went out to arrest Jesus. And they got in front of Jesus and listened to Jesus talking and hearing what he was saying. And instead of them arresting Jesus, Jesus arrested them by his words. And they went back to the Pharisees, and the Pharisees said, "Where's our captive at?" And they said, "We didn't bring him." And they said, "How come?" And he said, and they said, "Because we never heard anybody speak like that." What is that telling us? That's telling us that not only was Jesus' deity showing through his words, but that the truth of the Word of God was coming through him. They had never heard anybody speak like that before, because all they had ever heard previously was a bunch of mumble jumble that was lies leading them into the direction of eternal damnation. Okay? Sometimes that can happen in churches today. It doesn't necessarily have to be as extreme. But sometimes we take a particular thing in church, in this particular case, their own specific little pet doctrine, they took this and made this so righteous that anybody that didn't abide by it was guilty of sin. You know what the Old Testament says about that? You're supposed to be stoned to death. That's what they did. Some churches in America today forget who they're there to worship and begin to look at church like a country club, where they come to get to feel good and hang out with their friends. And, you know, in some cases, you know, people dress to the extreme and put on all their bling so when they go out, they can show off their wealth to everybody, right? But sometimes, in the midst of that, we create idols. How do I say that? Sometimes, when we neglect to pay attention to the Word of God, all of a sudden we're paying attention to something that we desire is more important. No offense intended to anybody in this room. But there are some churches that are King James only churches. And those people absolutely refuse to study any other translation that's been written. Now let me say this. I study the King James translation. I study the ESV, the NIV. I study all different texts, and I try to study every text as I'm writing a sermon because I want to know what your Bible is saying compared to my Bible. That way, if there's any significant difference in the vocabulary that's used, then I can explain that. Okay? But in some cases, churches will take something like that and create within their environment, for lack of better words, King James only environment. If you don't fall under that authority, if you utilize the English Standard Version like I do, or the NIV like Brother John used to, or some other text, right? If you utilize those things, well, you're not one of us. You're not one of us. So it creates a heartless, cold, arrogant attitude toward what we're actually supposed to be learning. And that's the problem we have here. They're cold, they're arrogant, they're relentless. They've created their own little idol. They refuse to go and look at the truth, and therefore they contend that Jesus is a blasphemer. Let me give you a few little things that can happen if you create your own laws. They continually need to be changed. Think about it. Right now, where we're at, right? A man that was blind can now see. Do you think the Pharisees anticipated that? I don't think so. So what are they going to have to do now? They're going to have to add something to their book to deal with this problem that they have. See? So it is something that continually needs to be changed, continually needs to have things added to. It takes accountability off of God and puts accountability on man. The Pharisees confuse their personal preferences with the law of Moses, the law of God. It introduces inconsistencies. This guy over here in Jerusalem is teaching his way of thinking that the Mishnah explains stuff. The guy in Galilee is teaching what he thinks the Mishnah is saying, and it's creating inconsistencies because nobody ever taught them that much. Right? It creates a false standard of righteousness. All of a sudden, we don't live, rephrase that. We, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ and under this roof today, or on that video or radio, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you are under Jesus' authority. You are under the new covenant. Your standard is the same always. There is only one way to the kingdom of heaven, and Jesus says it himself, I am the truth and the way and the life, and no one can get to the Father except through me. Yeah. Right? And there's only one way. So it can create false standards. False standards. Oh, there's many different ways to Jesus. most importantly above all of that is Jesus obviously rejects it because he's deliberately stirring the pot trying to get them to see the error of their ways. Okay? Jesus is cool like that. So, as we think about those things, and we think about the other part of these people, the other part of these people said, how can a man who is a sinner do such things? How can a man who is a sinner do such things? Did you know, as a believer in Jesus Christ, you can do some nice things for people? Did you know, as a non-believer in Jesus Christ, you can do nice things for people? Did you know that you can be a well-respected, well-loved individual in society and have no idea who Jesus Christ is? Did you know that? Yeah. That's 100% right. They say, how can this man who is a sinner do such things? God allows some men to do things even outside of being a believer in him. As a matter of fact, sometimes God uses those very people to straighten us out. Right? Sometimes you hear things like this. I don't go to church because everybody there is a hypocrite. I respond to that, though, by saying, considering you just testified that everybody is a hypocrite, come on and join us because you look like us. Right? But then next, let me say this about that. Satan, in case you haven't figured it out at this point in your life, is against God. Satan's main objective, every breath you believe, is to tear you away from the grips of God. These men say, how can a man that is a sinner do such things? First off, as we'll see later on down the road, first off, this is something that's never been done in the history of the world. First off. Secondly, we don't really think that Satan would do something to take our eyes off of our sin and put our eyes on Jesus, do we? No way. Satan is never going to try to take your eyes off of him, off of your sin, and encourage you to put it on Jesus. No, his main objective is to take your eyes off of God and put them on him. That's his main objective. That's his whole goal. That's his entire purpose of being. So it must be from God. And there was a division among them. So they said again to the man, what do you say about him? Since he has opened your eyes, this man said, he's a prophet. He's a prophet. They probably didn't want to hear that, especially right now, right? They already, in spiritual battle with Jesus. They've already formed an opinion of Jesus. They're already seeking to find a case against Jesus that would legitimize their hatred toward him. Okay? And this guy who has never seen, I want you to think about this. If you listened to the text or you went back and read it or you read it right this second, you will notice that the man has never seen Jesus. If Jesus was in a police lineup, that guy couldn't identify him. Right? Why? Because he's never seen him. The man was blind when Jesus put mud on his eyes. He was blind when he departed from Jesus and went a couple hundred yards over to the pool of Siloam. He was blind until he washed his eyes and returned. And at that point, Jesus wasn't there. Jesus already gone. This man knows, though, that as a Jew, irregardless of whether you're blind or lame, you still have to know the law. still by, he's a man. So by the age of 13, he still needs to be able to recite the law. He needs to be able to talk about Genesis and Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. He needs to be able to talk about that. But if he's really paid attention, what it appears he has, he knows that in those books, prophets were sent by God. Only God can send a prophet that can do a miraculous work like he's done here. No one else can do that. So they say, who do you say he is? He might as well have said, man, I think he's one of God's heroes. Because it would have made him just as mad as it did anyway. Right? Because that's basically what he's saying. He is a prophet. He's a spiritual hero. He's a man sent from God. He's anointed by God to lead people to him. All of these things is what this man is saying in that one word, prophet. So, because of the unprecedented incident that happened last week, we're walking through this week, And we realize now that the Pharisees are even divided. And some of them say that how can a sinner do this? In other words, translated, he must have come from God, which was your first point. Your second point is this, confirmation of the blindness. Confirmation of the blindness. Which just happened to me when I took my lights off, eyes off. Confirmation of the blindness. Verse 18 says, the Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called his parents, of the parents of the man who had received his sight. They didn't believe. Remember, I mentioned earlier about what we learned a couple weeks ago. When the man came back from the pool of Siloam, people were divided. Right? Some of them said, oh yeah, this is the guy. Other ones said, no, it's somebody looks like him. The Pharisees, they're kind of rolling the dice on the crap table right now and hoping that these parents come in and say, we don't have a clue who that guy is. Can't be our son. Our son was born blind. Right? But instead, the worst thing that could happen for them happens. Verse 19 says, and asked them, is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see? They asked three questions. Is this your son? Was he born blind? How does he now see? Watch the parents' response. Yes, this is our son. Yes, he was born blind. And we have no idea how he can see now. Not only that, we don't know who helped him get to that place. Why? Why would they throw that last little tidbit in there? We don't know how or who helped him. Why would they do that? Well, John gives it to us in his parenthetical statement in verse 22. Here he says, his parents said these things because they feared the Jews. For the Jews had already agreed that if anyone should confess Jesus to be Christ, he was to be put out of the synagogue. He was to be put out of the synagogue. Do you see what just happened there? The authority of man overrode the authority of God. The Pharisees were the spiritual leaders, biblical leaders. They were the ones that were supposed to teach everybody, guide everybody, keep everybody out of the Romans' ways, not stir up any crowds or problems or anything so that didn't draw attention to them from the Romans. But they were also relentless. If something went against what they desired, they would see to it that whoever violated that was punished to the utmost ability, right? They would essentially crush that person In this particular case, John let us know in his little parenthetical statement that the way that they intended to crush any of the Jews at this particular time was if they confessed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, they're going to put them out of the synagogue. Kick them out of church. That's what it boiled down to. Right? The problem with that is, though, that these parents, they didn't testify to that. Instead, what they did, they said, ask him. Ask our son. He's of age. He can speak for himself. We're not going to attempt to be excommunicated from the synagogue. We're not going to all of a sudden be an outcast in society. We're not going to be looked upon like a leper and people wanted to keep us outside of the city because we violated the Mishnah so bad that we got kicked out of the synagogue. They don't want that to happen. You see, their prestige, their comfort, their actual way of life was in jeopardy, determined by how they answered that third question. And so they said, ask him, he knows. We don't know what happened. We don't know what happened. Therefore, his parents said, he is of age. Ask him. Ask him. Let me ask you today, church. Are you feeling the gravity of this story? Are you realizing that yes, this was documented by John. And we know that this is the authoritative word of God without error in the earliest manuscripts. We know that this particular section of the Bible has no controversies against the fact that it actually happened. Right? And so this is an actual event. John is utilizing it, and Jesus is utilizing it to show us a spiritual problem then and a spiritual problem now, and that is blindness. Blindness is us walking around continually banging into the wall of failures and faults and messed up relationships and all of these problems. In other words, we are living out as non-believers in Jesus Christ. We're actually living out the definition of insanity, doing the same thing over and over and over again, thinking that we're going to get a different result. The only result is Jesus, beloved. There's only one result. If you don't seek Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're going to keep on bumping your head. You might even bump your head so many times you go even blind physically. But Jesus is showing us there is a spiritual aspect to that. Jesus is saying, just like these Pharisees, the majority of the known world at that time and the majority of the known world today is absolutely blind. People don't know who Jesus is. A lot of people think they know. They don't. People don't know who Jesus is. So in asking questions, are you blind today? Are you blind? Or has your sight been impaired by something? Keith's going to make his way up here and we're going to prepare to close, okay? But in preparing to close, I want to remind you of something. Salvation can only be sought through Jesus Christ. Salvation is one of those churchy words, I know. In Romans 3, the author of Romans says this: all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All have. None of us are righteous. None of us are. The book of Acts says that if we repent, and as I mentioned, I love this verse because it actually explains it. If we repent, if we use that church word repent, if we repent, which means actually to turn and go a different direction, if we do that, we are beginning a journey, right? And as we begin the journey, John tells us in 1 John 1:9 that if we gain enough courage, we can confess our sins. And that the Lord is just and faithful to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Too many people in the world today say, I've got to get things straight before I come to know Jesus. You're never going to get there. You're never going to get there. Jesus is the standard. You don't have a chance. Right? Confess your mess. If you confess your mess, again, Romans tells us, if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we would be saved. You see how simple that is? If we confess with our mouth, in other words, I can't give your sins to Jesus for you, you have to do it yourself. Grandma can't do it for you either. Okay? You have to confess with your mouth. And you have to believe in your heart. And if you do so, the Bible says that you will be saved. Beloved, I don't know about you, but we came into this building today, and we came in here, and we got to witness already a miraculous work of God whenever we all participated in Jason's baptism. Now, beloved, let me ask you this. How much more exciting would it be if I couldn't empty the baptistry because so many people was coming to Christ was baptizing them every week?
Amen.
Man, I tell you what, I'm looking for that day.
Uh-huh.
I'm looking for that day.
It's coming.
Right? Yeah. And I know it's coming, Brother Ray. I know it is. Yeah. I know it is because you stirred up, if nothing else, right? So look here, beloved. Know where you at. You lost, don't know Jesus? I don't know. You strayed away from the Lord, strayed away from the Bible, strayed away from your attendance at church. You know, you kind of been wandering around out there in the wilderness, and God's finally drawn you back in, or he's beginning to draw you back in. I don't know. You know, I don't know. Somebody might be just checking a box. Yep, made it to church today. Didn't listen, didn't learn. Utilize some energy and some fuel to get to church so I can check a box. The Word of God says you can be saved. And you can do that without doubt. You can do that knowing that Jesus will not lose any of his sheep. He will not lose any. And if you're one of his sheep, beloved, he's got a hold on you. And you can try all you want to wiggle and worm your way out of it. But if when you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you did it from your heart, he's never going to let go of you. So this altar is open to you for whatever reason or way you need to do business. You come on. And if you aren't here and you're on the video or on the radio, you contact us and let us know, because look, we're going to celebrate that with you. We're going to celebrate that with you.